Okay, how's that? Okay, topic that you asked for today is Bible and sciences, or conflict or agreement. And you haven't heard that much about reasons to believe. Well, I guess you already have, thanks to Hugh Grant. But our real target is to go after leaders. We notice that there's a lot of organizations out there that target the general populace, but that we see a real need to reach out to the leaders of society. And what I discovered many years ago, not only in California, but in different countries around the world, is that it's very difficult to reach out to these leaders through something that happened 2,000 years ago. But they will listen to something that was discovered 48 hours ago. So that's kind of our mission, to take the latest scientific discoveries, sometimes only hours old, and then use those as a way to reach out to leaders of society. You know, one of the other free things we offer through Reasons to Believe is called Science Newsflash. And often within hours of a discovery, we'll come up with a 10-minute report on that particular discovery. You'll see those on our website, and then you can download them literally minutes after we record them. We get them up right away. And also you'll notice on our website that we give you a written report every day. You can get about a 1 to 3 page report. It's written for lay people, talking about some of the latest scientific discoveries that give more evidence for the Christian faith. And if you want links to the actual research papers, we provide them right in the thing on your computer. You can link right to those papers. And that's available as a free email to your computer or at the computer of any friend of yours you want to receive this information. Now, all of that, let's actually get into the subject, Bible and science. And the Bible, according to the Bible, is inspired by God. Many passages of the Bible speak about how God inspires the words of the Bible. They're written by men, but the Holy Spirit inspired men to write what they record. In fact, there are passages in Peter, for example, where Peter refers to these prophets and apostles longing to understand what the Holy Spirit was inspiring to write, but recognizing that it was for a future generation, not for them. The Bible inspired by God. And then the universe is created by God. Again, this is repeated many times throughout the Bible, that God is the one who brings the universe into existence. And so we have the Bible on one side, we have nature on the other, the universe. And since God cannot lie or deceive, 8 times in the Bible it tells us it's impossible for God to lie or deceive. Now, if all this is true, if the Bible is inspired by God, if the universe is created by God, and God can't lie, then that implies that the words of the Bible can never conflict with the facts of nature. There's no possibility for conflict, given these three truths. On the other hand, we notice, and by the way, this is also a part of the Reformation. You know, what really launched the Reformation was this theology of two books, that God has given us two books. He's given us the book of Scripture, and he's given us the book of nature. And then here's just a brief quote from the Belgic Confession, referring to the book of nature. We know him, God, by two means. First, by the creation, preservation, and government of the universe, since that universe is before our eyes like a beautiful book in which all creatures, great and small, are as letters to make us ponder the invisible things of God. And you might say, well, where did the Belgic confessors get this from? It's Psalm 19, verses 1 through 4, where it talks about the heavens declaring the glory of God and how God has written his message upon the heavens for all of us to read. So that's where these people got the idea that nature is like a book that is to be read, and we're all literally letters within that book. Well, then how do we explain this public perception of conflict between science and theology? I mean, I hear it everywhere I go on university campuses, is that, you know, these are two things that just can't mix. Well, the problem here is that theology is not the same as the words of the Bible. Theology is the human interpretation of the Bible's words. And anytime anybody picks up the Bible to read it, they're interpreting it. And all of us interpret what we read. And likewise in science, it's not the same as the facts of nature. Science is the human interpretation of the facts of nature. And again, anytime a scientist looks at the record of nature, he is interpreting what he is seeing from the record of nature. Now, because it's human beings that are doing the interpretation, there is a possibility for mistakes and errors and biases. And therefore, we would expect that there's going to be many occasions when theology will contradict science, even though the facts of nature and the words of the Bible are perfectly in concord. And that's going to happen again and again. And you say, well, how do you go about figuring out where the mistakes and the biases are taking place in the human interpretation? The thing that attracted me about the Bible when I picked it up for the first time at age 17 is it not only exhorted us to put everything to the test, it taught us how. For example, we have the Apostle Paul making the statement, everything is to be tested. You know, that really appealed to me as a young scientist, that we're not just to have blind faith, we're to put it to the test. If it proves to be good, then you act upon it. If it proves to be false, you reject it. And this is something you see throughout the Bible, Old and New Testament, this constant appeal to putting things to the test. Test the spirits, John said. Malachi, where God asks us to put him to the test. But what really encouraged me about the Bible is it not only exhorted us to put things to the test, it showed us how to put things to the test. Now, you know, I was educated here in Vancouver. I went through high school and undergraduate education here, and had the privilege of getting an excellent elementary and high school education. And every year, starting in grade one, I was taught the scientific method. Now, in the United States, they don't do that. But here in British Columbia, every single year, we got exposed to the scientific method in greater depth. But none of my teachers ever taught me where the scientific method came from. And it really wasn't until I picked up this Bible that I figured out where that scientific method arose. It comes straight from the pages of Scripture. And it's really no accident that the scientific revolution was birthed in Western Europe at the time of the Reformation. The Reformation is when people for the first time were reading the Bibles for themselves, not depending on the priest, but reading it for themselves. And early science researchers at the time of the Reformation, as they went through the Bible, they picked up this testing method, and that was the birth of the scientific method. In fact, I prefer to call it the biblical testing method rather than the scientific method. And what I'm actually going to do here this morning is give you an example of how this scientific method plays out within Scripture. And what you'll notice is whenever the Bible describes a sequence or a chronology of physical events, you're going to see this pattern that we can now call the scientific method. And really what the scientific method is all about is doing what it can to guard against weak human beings making interpretations too quickly and investing too much emotional commitment in that interpretation. And so from a biblical perspective, God knows that we human beings tend to form interpretations before we're properly prepared. And we tend to invest too much of our emotions into that interpretation. And that really explains a lot of the controversies that take place both within the church and outside the church. Is that we form these quick interpretations, we emotionally invest in them, and then we fight one another. And so this biblical testing method is designed to prevent that from happening and to guide us on a sure pathway to avoid these misinterpretations. And it was Galileo at his court trial that made the statement to the Roman Catholic prelates that the biggest mistake you can make in Bible interpretation is to fail to identify the frame of reference. And as a scientist, he was most famous for making the point that frame of reference identification is critical to correctly interpreting a scientific experiment. And indeed, that is true. If you don't identify correctly the frame of reference, then you're really going to get things wrong, both biblically and scientifically. And the second point is, we're to make no attempt to interpret until we also establish what the initial conditions are. And again, as science professors are working with their students, we tell them, don't even think about beginning the experiment until you know what's happening before the experiment starts. Note those initial conditions. And then you perform the experiment, you read the text, or you make observations, depending whether you're doing astronomy or chemistry, or reading a passage in the Bible. And again, what we do as science professors, we tell our students, when you do the experiment or make the observation, don't interpret. Simply notice what's happening, when it's happening, where it's happening, and the order in which it's happening. That's all you're going to do. And we give them a notebook, and those of you who are science professors in the audience know how difficult it is to train the students simply to write down what's happening and don't add any interpretation. And then having done all that, you want to note what the final conditions are and how they differ from the initial conditions. Up to this point, no interpretation. You're just going through the preliminaries here. But step five is where you make an initial interpretation. This is where you form an hypothesis. Now, often when I'm speaking on university campuses, I get people saying, well, theology deals with the why, and science deals with the what. And maybe sometimes they say that science deals with the how, or the theology deals with the how. But really, for any decent interpretation, it's going to have any significance, either science or theology, you need to address both the how and the why. And so again, when I'm working with scientists, the whole point is, if you don't address the why, the chances are you don't understand the how or what is going on in the phenomenon. But this hypothesis that you form is a lightly held hypothesis. Again, we tell our students, do not invest your emotions in the first hypothesis you try. This is a guess. It's an initial guess or estimate as to what's going on. And so we lightly hold on to that hypothesis. And then, most importantly, we want to test that initial hypothesis with further experiments, observations, or in the case of the Bible, additional biblical texts that deal with the same subject. So you test that hypothesis, then you revise your hypothesis accordingly. Now, this is not the end of the biblical method of interpretation. This biblical method is based on the fact that we human beings will never know and understand everything. So having gone through these seven steps, we've revised our hypothesis. What you now do is you go back to step one. And you go back to the identification of frame of reference and say, in light of these seven steps, did I make any mistakes in identifying the frame of reference? Maybe I need to make an adjustment there. And you want to go on to the initial conditions and say, in light of these previous eight steps, is there any need for me to adjust what I think the initial conditions are? And likewise, you go through the third step, the fourth step, you repeat the experiment and see if you missed anything in the first experiment that you perform or the first reading of the text. Now, when I first picked up a Bible at age 17, I started off on page 1, the account of Genesis 1. First time I read through it, I only picked up three initial conditions. The second time I went through it, I found a fourth initial condition, and that made a huge difference in my interpretation of the six creation days. So that's just a quick example of how you want to go through this biblical testing method over and over again. It's a repeating cycle, and it never ends. I'm still adjusting my interpretation of Genesis 1 as I go through this. I've been going through Genesis 1 now for 34 years. I've written five editions of a booklet called Genesis 1, The Scientific Perspective. And some of you actually have all five editions. And you'll notice that there are changes taking place in the editions. This is all the result of this biblical testing method, going through things over and over again. Which means there's no room for laziness in this whole process. Your work is never done. So just like a mother's work is never done, a scientist's work is never done, and a theologian's work is never done. We're going to keep learning new and new things. And this is really God's way of getting us on the path to coming closer and closer to the truth that He has. We'll never gain all of His truth, but this is a technique whereby we can come closer and closer to what He wants us to know and understand. Now, what I want to do here is quickly review for you the first part of my talk, how this applies to the first account of creation. Now, there are many accounts of creation in the Bible. I count 25 chapter length or longer creation accounts in the Bible, which gives you 24 opportunities to test your interpretation of Genesis 1. That's the wonderful thing about the Bible. It not only tells you how to put things to the test, but even within the text, it gives you many different ways to apply that. So for example, there's a controversy in your church over what the Bible says about divorce and remarriage. I got good news for you. There's about 2,000 passages in the Bible that deal with the topic. And so as you develop an interpretation of one text, you can put it to the test by all these other portions of Scripture. You know, people ask, why does the Bible contain so many words? It's in order to give us this internal opportunity to put our interpretations of the text. So just like a scientist wants to perform multiple experiments and observations in order to fine-tune their interpretations going on in the record of nature, we see that that's already built into the pages of the Bible itself. Well, let me just begin by opening up this first chapter of Genesis, showing you this biblical testing method. And keep in mind, this is something you can apply to any controversy about the science or theology. So, I mean, anything that's going on in terms of what's happening. By the way, we do this in our own church in Southern California. We purposely launch Bible classes on controversial subjects. Why? Because people have never darkened the door of the church. They love to come into a church and see a big debate going on. That's a fun thing for them to attend, and we try to get them involved. We give them assignments. But our main goal is to show them how we can use this biblical testing method to bring resolution to divisive and controversial topics. And when that happens, people join together, and you see a peace and a harmony that comes over. So a practice in our church is we don't run from controversies, we pursue them. Because we see them as an opportunity to draw people into our fellowship, get them engaged, and bring about peace and resolution in the process, thanks to this biblical testing method. Now, one reason why I chose Genesis 1, that is probably the most controversial chapter within the entire Bible for the modern American church. I mean, that's true all over the world. You know, I've given talks to the Zulus in South Africa, and likewise, this, for them, is the most controversial passage. And so I'm on purpose picking this as an opportunity to show you how you can apply this biblical testing method to bring peace and resolution. Well, the first part of Genesis 1 is not controversial at all. You know, whether you're speaking in front of a bunch of atheists or agnostics or Buddhists or Hindus or Christians, everybody agrees on what the first verse of the Bible is talking about. It's the creation of the physical universe. And so we have this beginning where the universe comes into existence, and then the universe develops from the initial background radiation into proto-galaxies and into the galaxies that we see today. Now, here again, we can see this opportunity to put what the first verse of the Bible is saying to the test. And I think Bruce Waltke was a theologian who was at Regent College here for a number of years. And I remember hearing a week-long series of lectures from Bruce Waltke. He spent the entire week talking about the first three verses of the Bible. And I was impressed with all the content he had in that talk. And he said, well, I got a 900-page book on this subject of the first three verses. And as far as I know, that's in the Guinness World Book of Records. But the most commentary a Bible verse, 300 pages for every single verse. But one of the things you notice about Genesis 1:1, it's hardly alone. There are many other passages in the Bible that talk about this beginning of the universe. And if you cross-reference these passages, it's quite clear what God is claiming in Genesis 1:1. But just to look at that first verse. In that first verse, it uses the word create. And in Genesis 1, you see the word create only three times. Once for the physical universe, the second time for soulish life, and the third time for spirit life. And that word that's used for create in Hebrew is the word bara. It means to bring something brand new into existence that never existed before. And so the claim is, and also when it says God created the heavens and the earth, a bit of an issue there, because the Hebrew word for earth has five different literal definitions, and the Hebrew word for heaven has three different literal definitions. But when you take the word for heaven in the plural, shamayim, and attach it to the word for earth, ares, in singular, then it takes on a ninth definition. So when you see that phrase heavens and earth, it doesn't mean any of the five literal definitions for earth. It doesn't mean any of the three literal definitions for heaven. It takes on an entirely different meaning. And it means the entire physical universe encompassing all matter, energy, space, and time. You say, that's a lot that you pull out of just that one phrase. Well, again, I remember Bruce Waltke explaining that in Hebrew, you have very few nouns. And so virtually every noun has multiple literal definitions. But whenever in the Hebrew they want to make a distinct definition, they'll combine two nouns and make a compound noun. And he says, we actually do that in English sometimes. An example would be the word butterfly. Butterfly does not mean butter, and it's not some kind of fly. If you put the two words together, it means something different from either butter or fly. Likewise, heavens and earth. But as you go into these other passages, it becomes quite clear that what Bruce Waltke is claiming actually is true. Hebrews 11:3 makes the point that the universe that we can detect did not come from that which we can possibly see or detect. In other words, it came from something beyond matter, energy, space, and time. We can detect time, space, matter, and energy. But Hebrews 11:3 says the universe did not come from that. It came from something transcendent to matter, energy, space, and time. And a lot of these passages, like Colossians 1 and John 1, speak about God bringing the universe into existence literally from nothing. Nothing that we can identify as nothing. They say, what are you talking about? Well, one of the last sermons I gave my church many years ago was Everything You Want to Know About Nothing. And how we have many different definitions of nothing. You know, like when my son's got something underneath his bed and I ask him what's there, he says nothing. What he means is nothing I want you to find out about. And likewise in physics, sometimes they use the word how, you know, matter came from nothing. What we really mean is that the matter came from space-time fluctuations at the quantum era of the very early universe. But that's not true nothing. What it's referring to here in Scripture is that the universe came from nothing. Nothing that we can possibly detect, not from matter, not from energy, not from space and time. God obviously existed before the universe did, otherwise how could we have this universe come into existence? He's not nothing, but that's what it means by that. Well, and incidentally, there are other passages of Scripture here which talk about an actual beginning of space and time. Let me quote one for you. The grace of God that we now experience is put into effect before the beginning of time, 2 Timothy 1:9, or Titus 1:2. The hope that we have in Jesus Christ was given to us before the beginning of time. Now there's two points there. Time has a beginning, but God was active in cause and effect phenomena before time exists. And this is really the reason why God is not a being who is created. Any entity that's confined to time, or time can't be stopped or reversed, must have a beginning and must be created. But God is the author of time. He creates time. He's capable of cause and effect before time even exists. Therefore, for him, there's no need for a beginning or an ending. Or as I explained at UBC last night, just take a plane, for example, like this. A length of time and a width of time. Because when God is doing cause and effect phenomena before time even exists, he's actually operating in the equivalent of a second dimension of time. Time being that dimension where cause and effect phenomena can take place. So what that means is, for the Creator, at a minimum, time is like a plane. And so you can have a timeline over here on the edge of this paper, infinitely long, but God can operate on an infinite number of other timelines that never cross or touch the timeline of the universe. As such, God has no beginning and no ending. He is not created. And the Bible is the only holy book that makes that claim that God has no beginning, no ending, and is uncreated. Why? Because he's a being that's capable of cause and effect phenomena beyond space and time. You know, as I picked up these other holy books of religions of the world, what I noticed is that they all talked about God or gods or cosmic forces creating within space and time that eternally exists. The Bible alone departs from that and says, no, God creates independent of space and time. Now, I'm belaboring this point a little bit, because of what has happened in the latter part of the 20th century and early part of the 21st century. Namely, that theoretical physicists have been able to demonstrate that what the Bible claims about the event of the creation of the universe is indeed correct. And it's all based on the theory of general relativity. And what happened beginning in 1970 was the publication of the first of the space-time theorems of general relativity. Now, I refer to these theorems as the most theologically significant advances in mathematics that humanity has ever produced because of the theological implications. What these theorems state is that if the universe contains mass, and if general relativity reliably describes the dynamics of the universe, then space and time must be created by some agent who is able to perform events beyond space and time. In other words, there must be a creative causal agent beyond space and time that's responsible for creating the universe. Now, these theorems have two conditions. They're only true if these two things are correct. They're true if the universe contains mass. But I would guess that most of you are convinced that the universe contains mass. And if you're a doubter, maybe you can get a bathroom scale up front, you can step on it and watch the needle go by, and that will persuade you that indeed the universe contains mass. And yeah, I don't know any scientist who doubts that. It's the second condition that's most crucial. The theorem is only true if general relativity reliably describes the dynamics of the universe. Now, when the first of these theorems came out, we didn't have a great deal of confidence that general relativity reliably describes the dynamics of the universe. But today we do. And today we do because of the fact that we've gone from three tests of general relativity to over a dozen independent tests of the reliability of general relativity. And when I was a graduate student, the best of these tests was able to prove general relativity's reliability to 1% precision. Now we're able to do it to about 15 places of the decimal. And the real credit goes to four different sets of binary neutron stars. Two neutron stars that orbit about one another. And of all the theories of gravity we have, it's only the theory of general relativity that predicts that if we got two extremely dense objects, that's what neutron stars are. A neutron star is a star that's, say, 10 times more massive than our star, the Sun, that collapses under its own gravity and collapses down to a size of about 6 miles in diameter, as opposed to a million miles in diameter. And at that point, it is so dense that not even protons and electrons can survive. They get fused to make neutrons. And so a neutron star is literally a crystal of neutrons touching one another from the surface all the way to the core. And what we have here are these two neutron stars orbiting one another closely. And you've got gravitational fields that are about a million times stronger than anything we encounter in our solar system. And general relativity predicts that when the gravitational fields get that strong, that these bodies will actually spiral into one another and merge and become a black hole. Now, there are four of these binary neutron stars we can observe. And in all four cases, we see them spiraling in towards one another. And we can measure the rate at which they're spiraling in, and it's exactly what general relativity predicts. And this is why today, we can look at the theory of general relativity and say it's the most exhaustively tested principle in all of physics and the best proven principle in all of physics. And if you're prepared to be patient for a few more months, this bottom figure you see there, that's the gravity B probe. That's a satellite that's orbiting around the Earth right now. And what it's doing is testing general relativity at that one place where we have the least precision, the Lenz-Thurring effect. So far, we've only been able to confirm that to 1% precision. The goal of the gravity B probe is to push that to 5 places of the decimal. And so that's going to be coming out within a few months. There'll be one more test that will have the reliability of general relativity. But even now, it's the best proven principle in all of physics. And that really does demonstrate there must be a causal agent beyond space and time that brought this universe into existence. And that means we have isolated the God of the Bible from not only atheism, but also from the other major religions of the world. And The latest of these space-time theorems, published by Arvin Borde, Alexander Glinkin, and Alan Guth, and in this paper right here, what they're able to conclude is that any universe that expands on average must have a beginning in the finite past, and therefore a causal agent beyond space and time. And they wound up concluding that all reasonable expanding universe models, what they mean by reasonable, a model of the universe that will permit the existence of life. I mean, if you've got negative time, you might get around the beginning, but you're not going to have life in that universe. So any model capable of having life existing within it must be subject to the relentless grip of the space-time theorems. Which means if somebody asks you, how do you know that God exists? And says, because I'm shaking your hand. You wouldn't be here, and I wouldn't be here, unless there was a causal agent beyond space and time that brought the universe into existence. That's Genesis 1:1. The critical thing is what happens in the next verse. The next verse, we get a shift in the frame of reference. So Genesis 1:1, the frame of reference, is the entire physical universe. But Genesis 1:2 changes that frame of reference to the surface of the earth. Now, what I find fascinating, actually quite disturbing, is about 80% of the commentaries that I have in our library on the Genesis chapter 1 actually fail to recognize that there's been a change in the frame of reference. And I'm sure many of you run into people outside the church who insist that Genesis 1 teaches scientific nonsense. And as I speak on university campuses, I hear that from the science faculty again and again, and from their students. But almost all of those misunderstandings are based on this problem. They're looking at Genesis 1 as a story of creation from the perspective of the universe and not the surface of the earth. There are two frames of reference for Genesis 1. The universe for verse 1, the surface of the earth for the six creation days. And if you fail to make that distinction, then the events of the six creation days indeed are utterly absurd with respect to what we understand from the record of nature. And this is what's referred to as the irreconcilable conflict between the Bible and science. And it's the one you see most promoted in discussions of this ilk. But you can evaporate it by simply pointing out there are two frames of reference. God was hovering over the surface of the waters. I mean, what could be more explicit? A frame of reference is not the heavens, it's the surface of the waters. Now, the surface of these waters, verse 2, also designates four initial conditions. Number one, it tells us it's dark on the surface of the waters, that the water covers the entire surface, that the earth is empty of life, and it's unfit for life. It's formless and void, empty of life, unfit for life. It's a water world, there are no continents. The ocean covers the whole surface of the earth, and it's dark on the surface of the waters. Four initial conditions. And it's critical that we understand those four initial conditions in order to correctly interpret what takes place in the six creation days. Moving into the third verse, Genesis 1:3, what does the text say? Let there be light. First thing you want to notice is it does not say God created light. It says let there be light. It uses the verb hayah, not the verb bara. God did not manufacture the light. He didn't create the light. He says let the light be. What's happening here? The surface of the waters is dark. When God created the universe of matter, energy, space, and time, notice that includes energy. There was light in the beginning. But it was dark on the surface of the waters. So there was light in the heavens, but it was dark on the surface of the waters. The atmosphere that surrounded the early earth was opaque to light. And what God did on the first creation day was to transform the atmosphere from an opaque condition to a translucent condition. Now maybe I had a slight advantage not reading the Bible until I was 17. Because by that time I knew enough about astronomy to realize all rocky planets begin their existence with opaque atmospheres. And so naturally the light would not be able to come through. And what was taking place on the first creation day and this transformation from an opaque atmosphere to a translucent one. An example I'm showing you here is Venus, Earth's sister planet. and it has an opaque atmosphere. Now, Earth began the same way, but God somehow transformed that atmosphere. Now, when I first read the Bible, I really didn't know how that transformation took place. Planetary science hadn't advanced enough at that point. Today it has. Today we know exactly how that transformation process took place. And it's actually something we show you in our DVD called Journey Toward Creation. This is a DVD where we take you on a journey from the surface of the Earth to the very edge of the universe, going back in time and process, hence our journey toward creation. But what I want to show you right now is a 3-minute video clip from this DVD that shows you how the transformation took place and why we see it as one of the most outstanding miracles that we can document in Genesis chapter 1. So let me see if I can get the sound here to work for you.
Moon exploration enabled us to confirm that lunar rocks differ chemically from Earth rocks. Through study of lunar rocks' radioactive decay, researchers discovered that the moon is in fact nearly 100 million years younger than the Earth. In the 1990s, a theory explaining the moon's existence gained wide acceptance in the scientific community. According to this theory, an object the size of Mars crashed into the newly forming Earth about 4.5 billion years ago. Most of the object's mass was absorbed by the Earth, but this collision also sent up a huge cloud of dust and rocky fragments all around the Earth. In time, gravity pulled those fragments together into one solid body, the moon. The Earth, meanwhile, lost its entire atmosphere, and a new, much thinner one began to form from gases released by Earth's crustal material. Such a collision may seem a disaster, but it proved just the opposite. It set in motion certain alterations to Earth's features that eventually made this planet a uniquely suitable site for life. The odds against a collision benefiting the eventual support of human life are staggering. The planet colliding with the Earth would need to be the right size, moving at the right velocity, striking at the right angle, made of the right materials, and occurring at the right time in the development of planet Earth. If any one of these factors were off by just a few percent, the Earth would be barren today. Unless that impact had occurred, Earth's atmosphere would be much heavier than it is, even heavier than that of our neighboring planet, Venus. Venus's thick carbon dioxide-filled atmosphere would mean instant death for all possible life. The extra mass Earth gained from the collision, along with its atmospheric revision, meant that water could exist on Earth in all three states: ice, liquid, and vapor.
And that collision not only set up the events of Creation Day 1, it also paved the way for Creation Day 2 and 3. Without that collision, for example, we would not have continents. We wouldn't have a strong magnetic field, and we wouldn't have a stable water cycle. And so, moving on, we recognize that on Creation Day 2, we get this abundant, stable water cycle. Again, the text says, let there be. It doesn't say that God created the water. It says, let the water be. Let the water be in two places. Water in the ocean below, water in the atmosphere above, where water evaporates and condenses. And it was that collision event that gave the Earth the just right mass and the just right chemical compositions to make that stable, abundant water cycle happen. Now notice that none of this was necessary for life in the waters. God was planning for future life on land masses that did not yet exist. So again, this is counter to the evolutionary paradigm, everything is mindless. Here it shows that the specific planning for future events is taking place. Then we have the formation of the land masses, and we recognize that through the collision event, planet Earth got super rich with uranium and thorium, and that produced the heat source that produced eddies within the mantle and that set up these crustal plates that would enable these continental land masses to form. Now, what you see here in the next graph is showing you the growth of continental land masses with respect to time. And when I first read the Bible, the textbooks were saying that continents had always been here. But the textbooks were also saying we have no idea how the continents got here. This is an open question. And it was actually right here in Vancouver, the University of British Columbia, where three geophysicists were doing research, and I had the opportunity to take classes from them in the 1960s, and they were part of this emerging discipline of plate tectonics. Well, today, plate tectonic activity is so well understood, we can actually reproduce the growth of the continental land masses with respect to time. And what you see there is this evidence now tells us that indeed at the beginning, planet Earth was a water world with no land masses at all. Tiny islands would next pop up thanks to volcanic activity, but erosion would quickly wear them down and the Earth would go back to a water world. And then finally, continents began to grow thanks to the conversion of basalts of the ocean floor into silicates, which would float above the basalts. But what I want you to notice here is that period when the continental land growth was most aggressive, when the Earth was about 2 billion years old. Well, if you take the six creation days as referring to that period of time from the moment that God first created life, the Spirit of God was brooding over the surface of the waters, bringing the waters to life, the origin of life, 3.8 billion years ago. So you take that 3.8 billion years, put the six creation days over, and indeed, creation day three is consistent with this period of the most aggressive land growth. So today we know that the timing of the growth of the continents is exactly what the Bible had said thousands of years ago. And then we move into the second part of creation day three. The moment that these land masses exist, we have the land producing plants. Let the land produce plants. And what we see here is that we're talking advanced plants, like I've got pictured here. But once the continental land masses show up, God produces the first of primitive plants, which actually transform the soils of the continental land masses to make way for the most more advanced plants you see in that photograph there. Then we move into creation day four. And what does it say again? Not that God created the great lights. He says, let the great lights be. Then it tells you what they're for. Let the great lights be, verse 14, so that, verse 15, they might serve as signs to mark seasons and years. And you say, for whom? Well, if you look at creation days 5 and 6, it's referring to all the light that God will create. It's going to take advantage of the visibility of the sun, moon, and stars as distinct objects in the sky so that they can regulate their complex biological clocks. So all the life that the text mentions before day 4 only needs the light. It doesn't need to see the positions of the sun, moon, and stars. Your bacteria really don't care where the moon and the sun is in the sky. They just need the light. But all the light after creation day 4 requires at least the occasional visibility of the positions of the sun, moon, and stars so that those creatures can reproduce at the right time in the year, migrate at the right time, feed at the right time. So this is when God is transforming the atmosphere from a translucent condition to a transparent condition. From a condition like today where the sky is overcast to where the clouds break and you can see the sun, moon, and stars. And even creatures as primitive as clams need to see, at least on occasion, the position of the sun, moon, and stars in order to regulate their complex biological clocks. Now, this is the most controversial part of Genesis 1 within the church today, and it's because of verse 16. Verse 16 says, so God made the sun, moon, and stars. And many people reading it in the English translation believe that the text is saying that God made the sun on day 4. And that's probably the most common ridicule I hear of the Bible by scientists. How can you, Dr. Ross, believe that the Bible is true when it says that the sun was made on the fourth day and plants can't even survive without the heat of the sun? Well, my response is that's not what the text is saying. That Hebrew is different from English. The Hebrew language doesn't have verb tenses. And so when you're translating from Hebrew to English, you're forced to impose a verb tense because we have a different verb structure in English than you do in Hebrew. In Hebrew, you've got three verb forms rather than tenses. One is for commands, like do this, do that. A second one is for action that's still ongoing, through the present and on into the future. And the third form is for action that has been completed at some time in the past. And that's what verse 16 is saying. The sun, moon, and stars were completed at some point in the past. It's not saying they were made in day four. It was saying they were made previous to day four. Either day three, day two, day one, or in the beginning. And you say, well, wouldn't it be convenient if Moses told us which of those four options? Well, in one sense, he implies it. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And so they were there before the 6 days, but they only become visible to creatures on the surface of the earth on day four. Well, let's actually look at some of those creatures. Here we see on creation day five, the emergence of small sea animals, what we now recognize as a Cambrian explosion 543 million years ago, where you see the sudden appearance of about 70 phyla of life, including our own phyla. You know, we're part of that grouping of animals that have body plans that are described as tubes inside a tube. You say, well, where's my tubes? Well, one of your tubes is your spinal column, and there's a set of bones that goes around that tube. But you have another tube, which is your chest cavity. You've got ribs that surround all the organs between the outside of your body and the inner tube that we call the spinal column. And so all the vertebrates are part of the chordate phylum. Well, chordates were present as a basic body plan right at the base of the Cambrian explosion. And the Cambrian explosion is referred to as the great embarrassment of the revolution, because all these phyla suddenly show up, and today we only have 30 phyla on the planet. So 40 have disappeared. And actually we now know there's two explosions. You got the Avalon explosion, and you got the Cambrian explosion. But that's what we're seeing in the fossil record. Life explosively comes on the scene in tremendous diversity and complexity, and then nothing happens for tens or hundreds of millions of years, and then you get another explosive event. So the emergence of these small sea creatures. This is the first time we see animals on the face of the earth that have appendages, internal organs, and body sizes of bigger than a centimeter. And virtually all the different kinds show up at once. And then in the second part of creation day five, it talks about a brand new kind of creature. Only the second time it uses the word bara to create something brand new. And here it's referring to God creating sea mammals and the birds, referring to both generically, referring to the whole spectrum of sea mammals and birds, and uses two verbs. Doesn't use the verb haya, let there be, uses the verb bara to create brand new, and the verb asa to make or manufacture. And so God made these sea mammals. He personally manufactured and constructed the DNA and the morphology, the bodily structure of these sea mammals, but he also placed them in something brand new that never existed before. And that brand new component is soulishness. And it's not quite what the New Testament refers to as soulishness, that's the Greek New Testament. In the Hebrew, it's referring to the quality of these animals to manifest mind, will, and emotions at such a level that they can form relationships with members of their own species and nurture them. I mean, these soulless creatures are basically the animals that nurture their young and care for the young and give emotional support to their young. But the other thing we notice about these birds and mammals, they're not only capable of doing that with members of their own species, they're also capable and very eager to do it with members of the human species. And what's fascinating here is we have God creating all these creatures designed to relate to human beings that don't even exist yet. So, you know, humans aren't even here yet, and yet they're already pre-programmed to relate to us, to nurture us, and to have this emotional relationship with us. So that's the mammals and the birds. And then we move into creation day six. And creation day six talks about land mammals. But it doesn't refer to land mammals generically. fact, it doesn't even use a generic word for land mammals. It just simply goes straight to three different kinds of highly advanced land mammals that God creates to serve human beings. So it refers to the three different kinds of land mammals that God created to cohabit the planet with us. And the three kinds are as follows. There are the short-legged ones that we recognize as rodents. And you say, what on earth do we need rats and mice for? Well, actually, they serve a vital purpose in launching human civilization. You'll see this in our book, Who is Adam?, our book on human origins. But one of the things scientists have discovered about human origins is that we almost immediately displaced the Neanderthals. Now, the Neanderthals were shorter than us, and they were much broader than we are, short limbs, they had short legs, short arms, and a huge nasal cavity, which enabled them to live in a very cold climate. And they were around, you know, during the Ice Age. But as soon as humans came upon the scene, we quickly replaced them. In fact, research now shows that the first humans, many of the first humans, were living in climate zones 15 degrees colder than what the Neanderthals could live in. And the reason why they were able to do that is because they immediately exploited these little furry creatures. And since I'm speaking here in Canada, I speak in Southern California, they have no idea what I'm talking about. You know, here in Canada, we have an industry of raising muskrats and weasels and ermine, and you know, these are little tiny creatures, and almost all the food they eat goes to making fur because they live in a cold place. So this is really a very efficient source of a clothing material, and they easily relate to us. So it's easy to have a whole bunch of these creatures. They're cheap to feed, they make lots of fur, and it keeps us warm, and that's how early humanity quickly displaced. The other thing we find with the earliest humans, we see that they had needles with eyes in them, little holes in them, and so clearly they were in the practice of sewing these furs together to make clothing. So today, thanks to PETA, this is a big industry today, but back in the early days of humanity, it was important. By the way, Ken Samples, our staff philosopher, wants to form another organization also called PETA, but it's people who enjoy tasty animals. And then we have two kinds of wandering land mammals that Jack speaks about. This is what it's doing. It's contrasting the short-legged land mammals that launched our civilization, contrasted with two kinds of long-legged land mammals. One kind being the beasts, the herbivores, the creatures that are easy to tame and are excellent creatures for supporting agriculture. So when you go to the farm, that's what you see. You see the biblical beasts. You see sheep and goats and cows. And again, they're very easy to support, cheap to feed, and they make lots of milk and meat and leather for you. And also, they're incredibly easy to tame. And you know, I've had the opportunity to see that firsthand here in British Columbia a couple of times when I was a bachelor. I would purposely take a vacation all by myself and go to a place where there's no roads, no trails, where I knew human beings hadn't been in 40 to 50 years. And the thing is, you can see these wild herbivores and just how easy they are to tame. Now, the easiest were the goats, the mountain goats. I mean, within a few minutes, they were eating my clothes and other things. And, actually, they were waiting for me to urinate so they could get the salt, but they were also wanting some attention. And so within minutes, literally, you could be, you know, stroking these creatures because they had never been abused by humanity. So you got to see that inner motivation to desire a relationship with human beings. But the text also talks about the wild creatures, those that are not easy to tame. But once you do tame them, the level of relationship you can have with them is far deeper and more meaningful and fulfilling than what you get with the herbivores. And again, you notice that. You know, I have two sons, and when they were little, they had all kinds of these herbivorous creatures, but what they quickly figured out is the ones that are the carnivores are the ones where you can really have a meaningful relationship. And they're difficult to tame, but once tamed, they make excellent household pets, as opposed to the herbivores. I mean, I don't know if anybody brings a cow into the living room. No one I know has ever figured out a way to house-break a cow. And moreover, they've got to eat all day. and so they really don't have that much time to relate to you. But the dogs we've had in our home, what I've observed is, and the cats aren't far behind, they're capable of consuming an entire day worth of nutrients and calories within about 2 minutes. Then the rest of the day, they're free to relate to the family and show us all of their tricks and relate to us and so forth. And then finally, we have God creating human beings. And here again, you see the word bara, God creates brand new. It also uses the word asah, God manufactures. Well, the physical stuff already existed. The soulish stuff already existed. What was brand new is the spirit. And only one species on this planet is body, soul, and spirit. You know, the text says that we were created in the image of God. As God is body, soul, and spirit, so are we body, soul, and spirit. And that's one of the things that we use to challenge the evolutionists. Where did the spirit come from? They say the spirit evolved from lower animals, but the lower animals show no evidence of the spirit. Moreover, we human beings are the only species of life that has the brain structure to support spiritual activity. We don't see it in the Neanderthals. Homo erectus doesn't have it. Only human beings have it. And so God creates us. And unlike the soulish creatures who can relate to one another and relate to us, we can relate to God himself. We're the only species that even wonders whether or not there is a God. I mean, Saturday before last, I was doing a debate in front of 700 atheists. And what I noticed is, as atheists who don't believe in God, they're extremely passionate about the non-existence of God. And I quietly observed to several of them afterwards that that was probably the strongest proof for God's existence given. So, you know, you guys do not treat God like the Easter Bunny. You don't treat him like Santa Claus or the Tooth Fairy. You're passionate about the non-existence of God. It's not that you don't believe in God's existence, you just don't like him. You don't like what he stands for, or you don't like what the church is doing. And most of them said, yeah, that's right. We're really not so upset about the concept of God, we just don't like Christians. So, well, okay, I know a few Christians I have a hard time relating to as well, so I can understand that. But you know, when I read Genesis 1 for the first time, the thing that really got me thinking was it answers the enigma of the fossil record. You know, this is the great challenge in evolutionary biology. The problem is we see extensive evidence in the fossil record for speciation before the arrival of humans. In fact, it's at such a high level it averages about one new animal species appearing on the scene every year. So on the average, one new one appears every year. What have we seen since human beings have shown up? We don't see any. No evidence of any speciation at the animal level taking place. You know, Paul Ehrlich in his book on extinctions, and this is a direct quote, we get to document the appearance of a single animal species in the world of nature. He's referring to the human era, but you go previous to the human era, there's extensive evidence for this speciation. Now, for 6 days, God creates. On the seventh day, he rests. And notice what the text says. You've got an evening and a morning for the first 6 days. There is no evening and morning for day seven. And therefore, we're still in the seventh day. And that explains why we don't see speciation. God's at rest. This is a New Testament teaching as well. John chapter 5, verse 19, where Jesus refers to the state of rest in which he and his Father are currently engaged. They're resting from the work of physical creation. But he's making the point they're still at work. They're working in other areas. They're simply resting from their creation work. Now, this is an interpretation that I personally developed out of Genesis chapter 1, one of the 17 and 18. But it's something you can put to the test. As I mentioned earlier, there are 25 creation accounts in the Bible. This is all posted on our reasons.org website, so you don't have to write this down. In fact, we give you on our website every single verse in the Bible that pertains to creation. So yeah, if you want to go through the entire Bible and see if anything's got about creation, we give you the list to make that happen. But what you notice here is most of these creation accounts are not in the book of Genesis. They're beyond the book of Genesis. They're beyond the writings of the five books of Moses. Many of them are in the New Testament. Now, what I want to just show you briefly is how you can use one of these creation accounts to resolve what is probably the most controversial part of what you've heard today. I mean, as I speak around the country, where people really go after me is my interpretation of day four. You know, doesn't the Bible say the sun was made in the fourth day? I say, well, Genesis 1 implies that the sun was made before the six creation days. But if we go through these other creation accounts, we can find a passage that doesn't simply imply it, it's explicit. And it's Job 38. Job 38 and 39 parallel Genesis 1. Job 38 reviews the first four creation days, four and a half creation days, and Genesis 39, the last part of day 5 and day 6. And so we want to get a test of your interpretation of Genesis 1. This is one of the texts you want to go to. Psalm 104 also takes you through all six creation days, as does Proverbs 8. But here's what it says in Job 38:9. I made the clouds its garment and wrapped it in thick darkness. And the it is referring to the ocean that covers the whole surface of the earth. And we go previous to Job 38:9, it's referring to creation day 1. Water covers the whole face of the earth, but notice that the text is quite explicit in saying it's dark because of the clouds. It's not dark because of the lack of light, it's dark because of the clouds. So where Genesis 1 implies that interpretation, Job 38 is explicit. So this is an example of how indeed you can appreciate that or put to the test your interpretation of Genesis 1. But that's just one of the creation texts. What you really want to do is go through the other 23 as well. In fact, that's a class I'm now teaching in our church, taking our church through the 25 creation accounts of the Bible, showing how they're consistent, but at the same time developing insights from the text that will help us to share how the record of nature is in perfect accord with the words of the Bible. Well, I have a lot more to share with you today, but I interrupted myself with a bunch of segues, so I'm going to stop right here and just throw it open for questions and discussion and let you take it any direction that you would like. So at one point, we're going to do a drawing for books. So I think what we're going to do is I'm going to answer one or two questions while somebody here picks up the cards, then we're going to give away some books and continue the Q&A time. So let me take a question from the audience.
Has the spirit got any physical substance?
Is your question, is the spirit a physical substance?
Yep.
The answer is no. It says in the Bible, referring to God the Father, that God is spirit. And what that means is that God is not physical. So he's not in any way as a spirit that confined to any of the laws of physics or the space-time dimensions of the universe. Likewise, the spirit within you. When you pass from this life and your physical body dies and decays, the spirit, not being fundamentally confined after death to the laws of physics and the space-time dimensions, leaves this physical realm. And so it's your spirit at the point of death that will graduate from this realm to the non-physical realm.
Has dark matter any physical substance like the atoms and the molecules?
Is dark matter physical? Dark matter is physical, but it's got nothing to do with atoms and molecules, protons, neutrons. Dark energy is an energy that's embedded in the space surface of the universe.
Well, has energy got any physical substance?
Well, you know, we astronomers refer to exotic dark matter as a substance. We refer to dark energy as a substance. We refer to heat as a substance. And so, but it's not stuff like we think of. I mean, the layman thinks of stuff as, say, like this podium up here, something you can touch, and you know, it actually resists your pressure.
One more question. Has antimatter got any physical substance?
Antimatter is a physical substance. So there are protons and antiprotons. I mean, we got a particle physicist here in the front row. He'll tell you that antimatter is just as real as matter. However, when God created the universe, he created it with the physics that would give us a very slight imbalance of matter relative to antimatter. And so previous to a billionth of a second before the beginning of the universe, probably a billionth of a second after the universe, What we have is a universe with almost equal amounts of matter and antimatter. And the ratio is about 10 billion and one matter particles for every 10 billion antiparticles. But they annihilated one another shortly before a billionth of a second after the creation event, and that generated a lot of energy, and what's left over is that one part out of 10 billion and one. And so in that sense, the universe today has a lot less mass than it did early in the history of the universe. And the only place you're going to find antimatter is where you've got very high energy events that convert the matter to antimatter. Does that help?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, good.
Einstein, I believe I'm correct, and this is way over my head, but I think Einstein said that energy can neither be created nor destroyed, which I always took as the definition of the existence of God at that point. Is that something that's valid?
Well, it's valid up to a point. You know, when God created the universe, from that point forward, the total amount of matter and energy is a constant. And it's going to remain constant until God conquers and removes evil and suffering. God created this universe to bring about the end of evil. I'm going to talk about that tonight at the planetarium, how that's the fundamental purpose of the universe. And the physics of the universe is designed to facilitate the efficient conquest and removal of evil. And once that happens, the universe will fulfill this purpose, and God will replace it with a brand new one. So in that sense, matter can neither be created nor destroyed until evil is conquered. And then God will replace this universe with a brand new universe. But what Einstein was saying is that you can convert matter into energy, and energy into matter, but nevertheless, the total amount of energy and matter remains a constant. Okay, we're ready for the drawing? All right.
Did anybody else want to be important? There's one more.
Our life.
The hand I saw. Yeah, go ahead.
Richard, you suggested that the first human beings killed animals to get their clothing from them. What about the text that says that they were vegetarians until the fall?
Okay, he was asking the question about Genesis 9, verse 2, where God says, you were vegetarians, and now you can eat meat. And how does that apply to all these little tiny furry creatures that were used to launch human civilization? Well, you know this fact in the story of Cain and Abel of Genesis chapter 4, that animals were being killed to serve for sacrificial offerings unto God. And so what we have in Genesis 1 is that they're to have a diet of vegetables, and for good reason, because at that point people had the potential to live 900 years. You're only going to live to be 100 or 120. You can have all the meat you want. It's not going to do you any significant harm as long as you avoid Japanese tuna. You're going to live to be 800 or 900 years. It's critical that you go on a vegetarian diet, because otherwise you're going to accumulate so many heavy metals over the course of those 800 or 900 years, it will shorten your lifespan. And basically what God was saying in Genesis chapter 9, I have shortened your lifespan to a maximum of 120. And therefore, you might as well eat meat, because it's not going to make any difference. But do notice that before Genesis 9, human beings were still killing animals, but not for food purposes. They were killing them for providing for sacrificial offerings and for clothing, but not for food. But after Genesis 9, God says you can now use animals as a source of food, because after all, you're only going to live to be 120 years. And at that point, he says he put the fear of God or the fear of man into the animals. And this is what we notice, is that animals that are being hunted for food will run away from us. But if you're like me and have had the opportunity to go in parts of the world where animals are not hunted for food, you notice that the fear of man is not upon them. They'll actually express their original desire to relate to us as human beings. And as long as they're not abused or being hunted, you'll see that happening. And British Columbia is one of the few places you can go where actually you can observe that. Almost everywhere else in the world, these animals have been abused enough. But that's what's happening in Antarctica, is that the penguins there, who never had any contact with human beings, didn't fear us at all. You go up and touch them and pick them up and hug them or whatever. But now that there are people abusing them, they're starting to run away from us. Question over here.
Basically, the Bible describes and designs the creation of Earth and the things that are happening here on this planet, but what about all of the other things that are happening in the universe? Is there anything, any information in the Bible to describe what all those other planets are for, what all this other stuff is for?
Well, yes, there is, and let me clean up a little bit of an accent here first. Thank you. I need those print papers for the rest of my time here in Vancouver and also for the next two cities we're going. But your question is, what's the rest of all those stars and galaxies all about? And we're talking about an enormous amount. The Hubble Space Telescope has shown us that as we look back to the very beginning of the universe, look back in time, we can see on that record about 50 billion trillion stars. So that's a lot of stuff that's out there in the universe. But I can tell you this, that if we were to look at the fine tuning of the universe based on mass alone, it's so sensitive that if we were to add a dime to the total mass of the universe, or take a dime away from the total mass of the universe, that would be enough to disturb its capacity to support life. And so all that stuff in the universe is there to make a home for human beings. We wouldn't be here, given the laws of physics, unless the universe had exactly the mass that it has. So all you want is one place for life. It still takes the vastness of the universe. Likewise, it takes the time. There's a very narrow window of time in which advanced life is possible. Now, if you're a bacterium, the time window is about 4 billion years wide. But if you're a human being, the time window is actually narrower than 100,000 years. Yes?
So then all of our ideas of trying to colonize different planets or that kind of thing, looking to support life on other planets, is that completely misdirected? Is that just, away from the actual design of the
planet? Yeah, I know we all heard the question she's asking. Is it misdirected for us to even have the ambition of colonizing other planets in our solar system and in the universe? I wouldn't say it's misdirected, but I would say it's expensive. And it's temporary. I mean, I have a lot of, I'm close to JPL, so I have a lot of friends there who are involved in this idea of trying to put people on Mars. But they're starting to be a little bit circumspect about that, recognizing that when you go to Mars, it's very different from going to the moon. When you go to the moon, you're only, 2 or 3 days away from the Earth. So if something goes wrong, you can get back to the Earth fairly quickly. That's not the case with Mars. Now, the fastest way to get to Mars is 6 months. But if it takes 6 months to get to Mars, it's going to take you 3 years to get back. Unless you wait 3 years for the next window where you can get back in 6 months. Either way, you're looking at about 4 years to get to Mars and back, under the best of circumstances. And you're getting outside of the protection of the Van Allen belt. Like when you go to the moon, you're protected from deadly cosmic and solar radiation for about 2/3 of the way. But if you go to Mars, you're unprotected for 99.9% of the way. And so now it's necessary to build a radiation shield. And then you've got the problem of gravity. Is that if you go to the moon for a little while, you're going to come back with a loss of about 1% of your bone mass. And it's permanent. You don't get it back. And so I think it was Yuri Gagarin, a Russian astronaut, who went up into space for a few months, and he came back with so much bone mass loss that he quickly died. And again, it's permanent. Well, in order to do that on Mars, you have to have artificial gravity. And so it's necessary to build a spaceship that's got a big, thick, light shield to protect you from the radiation. And that's a problem too, because lead has radiation in it. So, and then you've got to have artificial gravity. You're now looking at a very expensive spacecraft. And in order to keep the cost down below $250 million, what you have to do is make sure that the habitat space inside the spacecraft is small. And I think that's the most challenging problem. They've done experiments where they put six astronauts in a small box for 6 months, and they cannot keep them sane. In fact, the best they were able to do is they put eight women in a small cavity, and these are women that were extremely verbal and didn't know one another, and they survived a couple months longer than the astronauts. But even they lost their sanity after a while. And so now we're talking about sending a huge spaceship, and now we send this huge spaceship. Bottom line, you can read about this in Lights in the Sky of a Green Man, that the most economical way to make such a journey is to build an artificial planet. And if you're going to build an artificial planet, why bother going to Mars? I mean, just to make your own. It actually costs you less money. And you know, there's all this talk about transforming Mars and giving it an atmosphere that we can breathe. That's actually doable, but it only lasts for a few decades, and you've got to spend the money all over again. And by the way, the cost for transforming the atmosphere of Mars conservatively has been put at $40 quadrillion. Okay, and that only lasts a few decades, and you've got to spend it all over again. Once again, you're better off making your own planet. So, and that just tells us how beautifully designed our planet is for our existence. Yes, maybe you were there. Well, that's a good question. And actually, the next book I'm working on is going to be making the point that every soulless creature has a role in serving the needs of humanity in some specific way. That would include all the ones that are on the planet with us today, but also the ones that existed in the past. And the question she was posing was, well, what purpose would all these bipedal primate species serve that preceded us human beings? And you can pick up our book, Who Is Adam, at the back table. They've now documented about 10 distinct species of 2-foot walking bipedal primate species that preceded human beings. What we notice about those 10 species is that they existed over the past 6.5 million years. And as you look at the sequence, as you move from 6.5 million years ago to about 50,000 years ago, each one was a little better adapted or designed to hunt bird and mammal species. And the best of them all was the Neanderthals. And in fact, Neanderthal was so well adapted, it exclusively fed on large-bodied bird and mammal species. But what we also noticed is that these bipedal primates were limited to Asia, parts of Europe, and Africa, and predominantly Africa. And none of them existed in North America, South America, or Australia. Well, the thing that we've been able to document is that in Africa, the arrival of human beings resulted in the extinction of 14% of the large-bodied bird and mammal species. But in North America, South America, and Australia, it resulted in 85% extinction. And so because the animals, large-bodied birds and mammals, on North and South America, for example, had no previous exposure to bipedal primates, when human beings came, it was a tremendous shock and resulted in this widespread extinction. It didn't happen in Africa. It didn't happen in Africa because there the large-bodied bird and mammal species had the opportunity to adapt over the course of millions of years, and so that when human beings came on the scene, they'd be able to run away from these super hunters. And that's something we need to appreciate. We human beings are super hunters. Neanderthals could only kill the weak birds and mammals, the ones that were sick and dying, and the ones that were diseased, whereas we human beings can kill anything we want. And typically when we go hunting, we go after the best. Well, the problem with that is by going after the best, you wind up degrading the quality of health of that species. Whereas the other carnivores, they go after the ones that are the worst within the species, that actually benefits the health of the species. So, for example, a deer, if you've got carnivores that are killing off the diseased creatures, that actually improves the health and increases the population of the deers. But if you're knocking off the very best creatures, it does the opposite. So God, knowing that we human beings would be super predators, knowing too that we would fall prey to sin, and therefore our greed would get in the way, purposely created these bipedal primate species so that they would be prepared in advance for the shock of these super predators that are going to come upon the scene. And you say, why Africa? Well, Africa is where you've got the greatest number of large body bird and mammal species. There are many fewer than existed here in North and South America. So that's why the focus of attention was in those continental land masses where the greatest numbers existed. And indeed, that's where we see them preserved best. So there may be other reasons why God did it, but that's one reason we can conceive of. Yes?
In your writings, is there a particular book that you would recommend related to the whole area of creation, God's creation of supernatural beings? I think it's Genesis 6, it talks about the Nephilim and
right.
The whole thing of cherubim, seraphim, all of the supernatural beings. Could you comment on that?
Yeah, three of our books deal with supernatural beings. The Genesis question, you'll see an appendix in that book that deals explicitly with the Nephilim of Genesis 6:3. And by the way, you're going to see once again that we kind of practice this biblical testing method. We bring up the topic of the Nephilim. We say, let's look at every single verse in the Bible that deals with this subject. And let's see if we can figure out who or what these creatures were. And we lay out three different theories. But by integrating all the passages in the Bible, really the key is this, is to look at all the passages in the Bible that talk about son of man or children of men contrasted with son of God or children of God. And you'll see an enormous difference. Also, when you look at the Gospels, in the Gospels, Jesus calls himself the son of man. In the epistles, post-resurrection, he's only referred to as the son of God. And there's a reason why there's a name change between Son of Man and Son of God for Jesus of Nazareth. Likewise, you'll notice that human beings, before the resurrection of Jesus from the dead, were always called sons of men. And then redeemed humanity, human beings have given their lives to Jesus Christ in the epistles, are always referred to as sons of God. There's a reason. Anyway, hopefully it gives you enough curious to go back there and actually figure it out for yourself. And if you don't want to buy the book, then you can look up all the scripture passages and figure it out for yourself. Okay, beyond the cosmos and why the universe is the way it is, are the two books where we talk about the angelic realm, the seraphim, the cherubim, and the different angelic realms. Beyond the cosmos is where we get into exactly why God created those creatures, what purposes they serve, why the universe is the way it is, really gets into how humans relate to the angels and how God is using the physics of this universe right now to prepare us humans, to be rulers over the angels. And so, yeah, this life is kind of hard. This life is hard because God is preparing us for a challenging task in the future. One of the challenging tasks is we're going to be ruling over the angels. So it takes some preparation. Okay, gentleman in the red shirt.
I'm going back to a little furry animals.
Little furry animals.
You talked about them being created out of the clothing, but it wasn't until Adam and Eve sinned, right? Until they actually knew the clothing, essentially.
Well, that's true. Adam and Eve were not wearing clothes until they had sinned, and then God provided covers for them. Obviously, he provided animal skins for them so they could have clothing. So in that sense, God was the one that kind of showed them that you could use these animals for clothing purposes. But notice that Adam and Eve did not stay in Eden. God ejected them from Eden. And he also gave them the command, multiply and fill the earth. And that means they'd be leaving this place where you really don't need clothes to go into a world where you definitely need to have them in order to survive. And so,
but But wasn't the whole issue about the shame about being naked?
Well, yeah, that's part of it. Yeah, that's definitely part of it. Yeah. That's not the only reason why. I mean, we wear clothes out of modesty, but we also wear clothes to keep warm. So, you know, I have a sister that lives in Edmonton, and what she tells me about Edmonton is that streaking never became a phenomenon in Edmonton.
So. I guess that may relate to your whole theory of how universe was before Adam and sin.
Okay. Notice that the text tells us that God created Adam outside of Eden. And when he placed him in Eden, he told them, in the day that you eat of that forbidden fruit, you will die. Well, he'd already been outside of Eden. He saw the thorns and the thistles. He saw the death that was going on there. And he was put inside of Eden and said, ah, this is a garden that God has prepared. You know, it's one thing to buy a home where you've got weeds in the backyard. It's quite another thing to buy a home that's already been landscaped. The second is much easier to take care of. But Adam had the opportunity to see both worlds. Now sometimes people say, well, wasn't it Eve that was the first one to sin? And how come God dealt so directly with Adam as opposed to Eve? Well, Eve only saw Eden. She did not see the outside world. She was created inside of Eden. Adam saw both outside of Eden and inside of Eden. And so God would be held him responsible. He knew better. You know, Eve could claim ignorance. He couldn't. He knew exactly what was going on. And so once they were rejected outside of Eden, it was basically plant your own garden. What did God say? You have to work by the sweat of your brow. That means they're going to have to plant their own gardens. And because of their sin, they were going to be condemned to having to work more than is necessary. And that's what sin does to us. We have to work extra hard to repair the damage of our sin. And what does it say? It'll be more pain. And that's what sin does too. Sin does not mean pain for the first time, but it does mean that because of your sin, there's going to be more pain than you'd otherwise experience. Likewise, wasted time. But as they began to move out from Eden into the other parts of the world, they moved into places that were hotter than Eden and places that were colder than Eden. And as they moved into places that are colder, now they had another reason to wear clothes.
Isn't that a theory as well, that of you're supposing that it was that way outside of Eden? Where in Scripture, I don't see it saying what you're saying. But Adam went out and he saw the rest of the world and it had these stones and thistles. Where is that in Scripture?
Well, you do see the reference to the thorns and thistles. And clearly, Adam was not created in Eden. He was created outside of Eden. It says God placed him in the Garden of Eden. So that implies he was created outside of Eden. And the fact is that God talked to Adam, not Eve, about the warning, in the day that you eat of that fruit, you will die. And so, again, it's talking to a person that has some knowledge of that, as opposed to Eve. So, and you know, it's planet Earth. If you've got a planet, there's going to be cold spots on it and warm spots on it. The fact is, it's a spherical body. And so the heat from the sun is not going to evenly illuminate all parts of the body. And one thing the Bible is clear about is that we don't see a change in physics with Adam and Eve sinning. I know that's a controversy within the church, but all again you need to do is go through the entire Bible, look at everything it says about the constancy of physics. Jeremiah 33:25, the laws that govern the heavens and the earth are fixed. Or Romans chapter 8, where it says the law of decay rules the entire creation. And so the creation has always been subject to this law of decay. What sin does is it increases the rate of decay, but the decay was already there. So Adam and Eve were experiencing pain and work before they sinned, but after they sinned, they enhanced that. But what that tells us is that none of the laws of physics or the conditions of the universe were changed when Adam and Eve sinned. There was no systemic change in the laws of physics. That will happen when God conquers evil. Yes? I'm going to get over to this side. Don't worry. Go ahead.
Two-part question. One is regarding the Neanderthal, and the other one is regarding the solar creatures. Did the Neanderthal crossbreed with humans, and is there any evidence of that?
There was a claim in the scientific literature 2.5 years ago where they found this juvenile Neanderthal in Spain. And they claimed that they had found evidence by looking at the morphology of that creature that there was interbreeding going on between humans and Neanderthals. That claim has now been withdrawn. And if you want to read the story about it, it's in her book, Who is That? And you know, the really definitive test is the DNA. If you look at the DNA of Neanderthals and compare it with the DNA of humans, you can see that the Neanderthals made no contribution to the human gene pool. And now we have DNA from 12 different Neanderthal specimens. And again, if you look at that DNA, there's quite a difference between that and human DNA. The regions where the DNA of Neanderthals varies does not overlap the region where the human DNA varies. And this is why geneticists have now concluded that Neanderthals made no contribution to the human gene pool. That's just a piece of the evidence. There's a lot more evidence. The morphology is radically different.